The journalist James Cameron filed one of his best remembered reports about the China-India border. And the final line of that article recalled the time when 20,000 Chinese young pioneers, quote, stood holding hands, crying Hindi Cheen Bhai Bhai, and how beautiful it seemed, and how long ago today, unquote. So I think that was a story he wrote in the 1970s, recalling 1954. And it certainly seems like very long ago now, given how we think about China and what we think when we think about China these days. But in fact, the depth of our shared and interlinking history between India and China is immense. It's just the length of our shared border is immense. And whether you take the time frame as being one of millennia or one of decades, it always seems to be the case that that we regard it at best we are at best oblivious, and at worst we are ignorant. So there's never a better time to start correcting that than right now, and we have absolutely the right person to do so. One of the most distinguished figures in the Indian Foreign Service, Nirupama Rao, began her career, I think, was your first posting in, you just told me, in Vienna, and thereafter in Latin America, and then Sri Lanka. Were you not an envoy in South America at some point? Much later. Accompanied Prime Minister Rajiv Gandhi to China in 1988, which was the first visit that an Indian Prime Minister had made to China since the war.
Since
1954, in fact. And thereafter became India's first woman ambassador to China, and thereafter the first foreign secretary of India, which is, of course, the highest office in the Indian Foreign Service. And just to complete that phase of your career, went on to become the ambassador to the United States. So a truly awesome career, and much of it devoted to learning and studying and dealing with this enormous neighbor we have. Tell us a little bit about how your personal interaction or encounter with China began.
Thank you. Thank you for doing this, Raghu. And good evening to everybody here. Well, it's said about the relationship between India and China, and I recall what the Chinese Indologist Qixian Lin, who passed away a few years ago, but whose association with India went back to the mid-1940s when he was a student in Germany. And he would always say that the relationship between India and China was conceived in heaven but constructed on earth. And I think that thereby hangs a tale, because I think it will illustrate to you the complexities that are involved in any construction process. And we know that very well in India, I think. So coming to my personal experiences of China, if I may really start at the absolutely personal,
yes.
I would go back to the time I was about 7 or 8 years old. And I was an avid reader, and my father would bring home reading material, essentially for a little schoolgirl. But one day, I remember, we were in Lucknow, and at the bookshop in Hazrat Ganj, which is a commercial street, you can call it, in Lucknow. He brought home this comic book, which was from the People's Publishing House in those days. They called it Peking, and they call it Beijing now, of course. And it had this long title, which to a 7-year-old, 8-year-old seemed so, I was quite flummoxed with it. It said, Reconnaissance over the Yangtze. Now, the Yangtze, you know, is a river. We all know that from our geography classes, the Yangtze and the Huanghe, the Yellow River and the Yangtze River. Yangtze is like China's Ganga. So this was a story of Mao Zedong's long march. And there I was, all of 7 and a half or so, coming to an acquaintance with what had happened in China before the liberation, during the Civil War. And it was a story about these Communist Party volunteers who were crossing the Yangtze River as part of their struggle against the Kuomintang and also against the Japanese. So that was my introduction to China, and my introduction, let me say, to the word reconnaissance. I'd never known that word before that. And
long
then,
before you made your own first reconnaissance of the Yangtze.
Absolutely. And then I would cut to 1960. I was about 9 years old. And if you recall, I don't know how many of you recall, His Holiness the Dalai Lama had taken asylum in India the year before, in March 1959. And after spending a few months in Northeast India, in Assam, he was, you know, going to take up residence, where he is still now, in McLeodganj near Dharamsala. So in those days, you didn't fly, you took the train, you took the good old Indian Railway, and he was on this kind of long journey, which took a few days, from Assam, Misamari in Assam, to Delhi, and then on to Dharamsala. So the train stopped at Lucknow, where, you know, I was living with my parents, and they took me to see the Dalai Lama at the train station. And I still remember getting the Dalai Lama's autograph. And I know the date because I still have the autograph book, 14th February 1960. And so that was my introduction, both to
Valentine's Day was the day
Valentine's
that you fell in love
Day,
with China.
And I must say I fell in love with Tibet. Not with China, perhaps, but really with Tibet. And that continues today, to date. So that, my personal kind of, you know, when lifting the veil, as it were, on China was then. And then for a long, long period, of course, I didn't have any, you know, any such encounter with China or the Chinese. There was a war that was fought in 1962. And I remember that I, as a young girl, going for orthodontic treatment to my dentist in Kunur. We lived in Kunur near Uti. And he was this old dentist. In fact, he died before the treatment was over. So I wasn't responsible, I can assure you. But he tells me as he's sort of, and I'm in pain, he's trying to, you know, wrench some teeth out of my mouth. And he's speaking of Chinese torture. And this is 1962. So there again, I have this impression of what China, you know, in the imagination of a young girl could be like. I joined the Foreign Service in 1973, and I didn't study China immediately, of course. I went to Vienna on my first posting. I learned German, and then I went on to Sri Lanka on another posting. And then it was only about 11 years into my, you know, being in the Foreign Service that I started dealing with China. And that really was 1984. And the year that Indira Gandhi was assassinated, and I started studying
this,
China.
Before this prime ministerial delegation, which was an extremely major event, you had visited prior to that?
I did. My first visit to China was in 1986, 2 years after I'd started dealing with issues concerning our relationship with China. And I came to deal with the subject at a time when new vistas were opening up in the relationship. Mrs. Indira Gandhi was quite far-seeing in this respect. She took the stand that, she took the position that we could not, you know, adopt a policy which basically stated, here I stand and here I will remain when it comes to how we deal with China. That it was essential to dialogue, it was essential to speak to them, open channels of communication, and build more confidence that could contribute to peace and tranquility on our disputed border. Because the memories of 1962, as you know, are very much embedded in the national psyche here in India. They continue to be so. Yeah. But Mrs. Gandhi, I think, was trying to see how we could, in a sense, drop that kind of a sense of being imprisoned by memory, learning from that memory, but not being caged by that memory.
That seems very valuable. And I don't think that we have collectively succeeded in that yet. I still think that 1962 is a huge preoccupation and that it dominates what Indians learn about our relationship with China and completely eclipses the history that went before and the very very complex and immense relationship that we have right now that is not just about, not simply about borders and about military competition. But thank you for that story. I think you beautifully staged a couple of these eras or phases of the Indian relationship. The 1950s, of course, going back to Hindi Cheen Bye Bye, was a point at which India and China both emerged from nationalist struggles of two very different types, but found a very important solidarity in that moment. And then the arrival of the Dalai Lama in India was the beginning of the slide in our relations towards, please correct me if I'm wrong, towards the war. What was happening in 1984 when you got there? I mean, was that a landmark of a particular?
Yeah, you mentioned the freedom struggles of the two countries, and that brings me to this observation that, when you look at the Chinese, what they call the liberation struggle, which brought the Chinese communists to power, essentially, and the founding of the People's Republic. So they actually fought a military war. There was military conflict that brought them to power. There was, first, of course, the anti-Japanese war. Japan was in occupation of China, and there's a whole history involved with that. But there was also the civil war between the Chinese nationalists and the Chinese communists. It involved a lot of bloodshed. It involved a lot of violence. It involved a lot of displacing of people, massacres of population. So it's a very different experience from what we went through. And ours was a struggle based on Gandhian nonviolence. We took on the might of the British Raj. But the whole sequence of developments was so different from what happened in China. And in many ways, I think when you looked at leaders like Mao Zedong and Zhou Enlai, you know where they were coming from. They were essentially military commanders. They had been conditioned by the crucible of war, really, when they came to the leadership of the country. Our leaders' leadership was conditioned by very different experiences. Mahatma Gandhi, of course, died in January 1948, but his anointed, the person he felt was the anointed leader, Jawaharlal Nehru, came from that experience. And he had this vision of a united Asia, of peoples coming together, where China and India would play a very, very leading role in ensuring this unity of people who had been subjugated by Western dominance and were coming into their own. And there, his vision of China was therefore conditioned by that. But whether the Chinese responded equivalently, I would have my doubts. Because in their case, I think it was more about tactically maneuvering with India, building so-called peaceful coexistence. Whereas I think with Nehru, it was, ensuring that China got its rightful place and letting it come into its own. So that is the, background. But when you come to 1984, you're essentially dealing with a relationship that had been somewhat in a state of a very quiescent state. I mean, you've fought a war, you've had confrontation even after that in 1967. And then 1970, you have the famous Mao smile when on Tiananmen Square, when he greets our chargé in Beijing. We didn't have an ambassador at that time, Brajesh Mishra. He greets him with a handshake and a smile and says, "How long can we go on being like this?" or words to that effect. So that really, is another watershed. And then I mentioned Mrs. Gandhi. You had the foreign minister level visit by Atal Bihari Vajpayee in 1979. And then you had their Chinese foreign minister, Huang Hua, coming here. So all this time, Indira Gandhi was encouraging this process of opening of dialogue. I came into it at that time, 1984. when dialogue had just begun, some green shoots you could see. But by and large, I mean, we steered clear of the Chinese. There was very little contact, very little people-to-people understanding. And then I cut to 1986 when I made my first visit, which was with a film delegation. We had Shabana Azmi and we had Sai Paranjpe going to China, and I was designated by the Ministry of External Affairs to accompany them. So it was a very unlikely scenario. Normally you visit as Foreign Service officers, you go with an official delegation, you go for some talks, you sign some memoranda, you come back. But this was a film week in China. And so I was introduced to a completely different, the world of soft power, really. I saw the way Indian soft power has an impact on the Chinese. There were people who still remembered Avara. They remembered Raj Kapoor, Large as they call him, because the R becomes L in Chinese, Raj Kapoor, and they would hum songs from Avara. And, you know, it was that kind of a mystique that India sort of exerted on the Chinese mind. Nobody spoke about the war. Nobody spoke, whereas if Chinese come to India, many of us still remember 1962. But in that 1 week I spent in China, there was no mention of the war. We just visited film studios. We met Chinese actors and actresses and important directors. And we saw China for the first time. We stayed at the Beijing Hotel. If you go to the Beijing Hotel today, it's a very modernized, a five-star sort of abode for tourists. But that time it was completely socialist, international kind of architecture. You had this huge sort of display in the lobby, very Chinese communist display with the red star over China, and saying, we have friends all over the world, which is just what Mao Zedong would say. And the Chinese people have stood up. You know, those are the slogans we saw. We saw women in their regulation blue tunics. The main boulevards of China in Beijing were just overflowing with bicycles, hardly any cars. And you go today, I've seen the contrast over the years, how China has changed. So this was China beginning to open up before Tiananmen. And the 80s are a very interesting period in China, especially in China's universities and places of learning, when students were, you know, they had this kind of renaissance at that time, exposure to new ideas. They were able to read new literature. The Americans had come in, ping-pong diplomacy, the Nixon visit. So this was opening up, reform with opening up, as Deng Xiaoping called it. And it was a period, when you look at post-Tiananmen, which is 1989, of relative freedom in terms of exposure to new ideas. It's a very exciting time to be in China because you saw a country changing. The whole face of the country changing. And where was communist revolution when you're talking of get rich fast? It doesn't matter if a cat is black or white, as long as it catches the mice. So you were exposed to this kind of pragmatism, very realistic appreciation of what they needed to do.
That's extremely interesting. So we can sort of summarize our modern post independence relationship with China as having included this period of great and loudly articulated warmth, and then outright hostilities and war and the chill that followed it. And since the 1980s, I think full diplomatic relations were reestablished in 76 or so. But since the 1980s, the sort of enormous new defining character of China was the power of its economy. And I believe China is now India's single largest trade partner. While we have so much else to fret over in our relationship with them, we also have to concern ourselves with the fact that the largest stakeholder in India's foreign trade, and that includes and that's also trade in which we run a substantial deficit. So no easy answers about what effect that has on us. But the modern era, the current, let's say the present era rather, is one in which there is both soft power being exchanged. There's enormous economic exchange occurring, but there's also military tension, and there's also rising and falling sense of risk and of hazard on our shared border. I think you described that somewhere, or you quoted a description of it of it being like a small boiling pot, or a small pot boiling over a fire to which we have to keep adding cold water. So in your position as a diplomat during this current era, was diplomacy the vehicle for adding cold water? And has that served us well over the last three decades?
Yeah, definitely. I think diplomacy was a means to diffuse tension. And dialogue is really the way forward. That's what we demonstrated. And I'll tell you why, because in 1986, coming back to where I stopped, we had the Chinese intrusion into a small area north of Tawang in Arunachal Pradesh called Sumdorongchu. And if it had happened today, of course, we would have most of our commando-style TV anchors talk just about that. But it wasn't that. The era was different. We had a couple of newspapers who picked it up, and it got into parliament also. There was
It was an analogous sort of situation to Doklam?
Absolutely. Although with Doklam, we have Bhutan. But this is a completely India-China situation. But it was an important pocket of territory, and the Chinese had come in and they had encamped there. They had shown no signs of leaving. They had built a helipad, and there was great concern about, and there was close confrontation, just as there was in Doklam. So very similar to that, and it went on for about 2 years almost. There was no diffusion, and the rhetoric, the decibel levels got higher. We had military exercises, they had military exercises. Things were pretty, pretty tense. And that was the time when Rajiv Gandhi, to talk about how diplomacy diffuses tension, he decided to take the step to go to China. It was like, you know, going to a place that we felt was a kind of enemy citadel, going to Beijing after what we had experienced in the relationship. But it just illustrates, you know, what a bold political decision can do if it succeeds. And it succeeded, did, because he went to China and he met with Deng Xiaoping, he met with the whole constellation of Chinese leaders. And I think that act of his, that initiative that he took helped to convey to the Chinese that we were essentially interested in building a constructive bilateral relationship with China, because we needed peace for our development. It was a selfish reason, but selfish in a way that promoted our interest and was good for the people of the country. And therefore, that initiated a new chapter in the relations between India and China. And that's from where you get the development, the growth in trade relations, the development of people-to-people contacts, so much so that today you have regular flights between the two countries, you have the huge trade in goods, you have Chinese investment, you have the Chinese mobile telephony in this country. You know very well how popular that is.
Xiaomi, 11,000 rupees only, fully functional smartphone.
I've seen an Indian Air Force poster on the internet which says, "Do not buy Xiaomi."
Z can hear everything that I say.
Really today we have 13,000 and more Indian students studying in China, and they're studying medicine. They're all over the country. I went to Western China, to Xinjiang. I met them in Urumqi. There were Indian students there all over the country, and they're from all parts of India, including from my home district in Kerala. I found young boys and girls studying in China. So the relationship has become much more multidimensional from where it was before. And I think in many ways that visit that Rajiv Gandhi undertook in 1988 opened the doors.
I was just speaking to Sujata Prasad, who is in the cultural ministry and part of the festival, to speak about her book about Sonal Mansingh. And she mentioned how even during at the peak of tensions over Doklam, she and other bureaucrats of the culture ministry were at the BRICS summit in Tianjin and were received with amazing warmth and were shown around Tianjin and Shanghai and what was happening at Doklam, which seemed to dominate anything we had to say about China over here, was not impinging on how the BRICS, how Indians were received at the BRICS summit, which it seems like pretty good proof that even at a moment of peak tension, it's impossible to disregard just how multifaceted and you know, like the million threads that are you know, pulling and pushing between India and China.
You know, I don't want to sound like Pollyanna when it comes to this relationship, because there are many, many complexities and tensions that, you know, sort of, that's the subterranean level that populates this relationship. We are competitors in so many ways, but we've also civilizationally coexisted in Asia. If you go to Southeast Asia today, you go to Singapore, you go to the Chinese Quarter in Singapore, there's a Hindu temple right in the heart of the Chinese Quarter. And if you talk to the Chinese in Singapore, they know all about, they know about festivals like Pongal and Diwali. And so that kind of coexistence of civilizations does exist in Southeast Asia, and which is why we call it Indochina. Because that's where India and China really have coexisted over the centuries. And today when we speak of the Indian Ocean and we speak of the rivalry between the Chinese and Indian navies and our dialogue with the Americans and the Japanese and the Australians and how we can counter the growth of Chinese influence, there is another, you know, world that we've inhabited over centuries through the connections established in the Bay of Bengal, through peninsular India reaching out to Southeast Asia, where the two civilizations really met and coalesced. Where does the word Mandarin come from? You know, we say the Chinese Mandarins or Mandarin Chinese or Mandarin Oranges for that matter. The word Mandarin has its root in the Sanskrit word Mantri. Mantri. So
that
Mantri begins Mandarin. So the Chinese Mandarins would wear these orange robes and they would be checking, you know, trade manifests and shipping manifests and in Southeast Asian ports, and they would be referred to as the Mantris.
Right.
The Mandris, you know, slightly, you know, soften the pronunciation.
Yeah.
That's how the word Mandarin came about.
Right.
So in pidgin, I suppose, but now of course it's usage everywhere. So let's understand that there are these two worlds that essentially have grown up side by side, exist side by side. You have a China where I have a friend, a young Chinese woman who runs a Bharatnatyam dancing school in the heart of Beijing and has these little Chinese girls in pavadas and, you know, with little half saris practicing Bharatnatyam, and she calls Leela Samson Leela Akka, and you know, so there's that kind of, and that is allowed to go on, as you said. And a movie like Dangal or Three Idiots is a big hit in China. Unfortunately, the Chinese don't allow the import of sufficient foreign movies. It's all clubbed together, Hollywood movies, Bollywood, other movies. So we need to open that world a little more. But the impact, I don't think we've been able to leverage sufficiently the strength of our soft power in places like China. There's an enormous matrix of acceptability for our soft power.
Thank you. That is really a very valuable thing for us to carry away from this. So we'll be excuse me. We have some time for questions, and I'm sure you guys will have many. But I'll so take a moment to think over them. I'm going to request you to only ask a question and not make a comment or add to anything that Nirupama ji said. Yeah, there may be mics in the audience, but before that, I want to ask one last question of you. I neglected to mention something important, which is that apart from, in your writing, apart from having the savvy of a career diplomat and the mind of of a historian. I think that what is also very clear in your, what comes through in your writing is that you have a very elegant writing hand, which I really admire and is obviously the most interesting thing to me. So I want to ask you a little bit about writing about China. I know that you're in the process of writing a book that is not out at this point, but also about expressing what it is you love about China. And the passages that I found most beautiful in your writing are mainly about Tibet and about the Himalayan regions. So have you visited there? And tell us about writing about those places.
Thank you. Thank you for appreciating my writing style. Coming from you, I really am flattered. Well, on Tibet, yes, that part of, today we call it a part of China. You know, Tibet is inner Asia in many ways. It's the heart of Asia. And when you think of the Silk Route and when you think of the connections that were established between India and China across Central Asia, Tibet plays a very important part in that. Yeah. And, you know, Tibet is what connects our histories in many ways, because you have the impact of Buddhism. When you look at Tibetan culture, and religion forms very much a part of culture, that identity of Tibet comes so much from India, from the religion that went to Tibet with Padmasambhava and others. Incidentally, I don't know if you're aware, if audience is aware, that Padmasambhava was a Buddhist monk or teacher who came from Swat, which is now in Pakistan. So you see how our destinies have been interconnected in so many ways. It's the borders that bleed today and separate us. And why, you know, I wrote that piece about a Himalayan consensus a couple of years ago was because I'm so, you know, knowing the history of this region and what has gone into it, apart from recent history, which dominates the discourse, is this whole millennial connectivity that has bound us together. You know, Martin Luther King used to say, a single garment of destiny unites us all. And I think it's so true of this part of the world. When you think of Asia, when you think of the Asia Pacific, when you think of what the Americans call the Indo-Asia Pacific, India is so much a part of that. India has given to this whole, you know, identity of all of us as Asians. And the Chinese have influenced it also. Tibet, because of the religious connection, because of His Holiness the Dalai Lama, because many of our holy places like Kailash and Mansarovar are in Tibet, I've always been drawn to Tibet. And I went to Kailash and Mansarovar in 1986 as a liaison officer for a group of pilgrims from India. And we trekked from Darchula in Pithoragarh, what is Uttarakhand now. And it took us about 12 days to reach Lipu Lake, which is the border pass between India and Tibet. It's at about 14,000 feet above sea level. Sorry, I'm not saying it in the metric measure. But we then went into Tibet, and being in Tibet, you know, when you're high up, you know, average heights of 12,000 to 19,000 feet, which was the highest point one went to. Just the physical experience of being in a place like that, it can really, you know, leave a very deep impression. The sky is so close. I mean, it's literally so physically close. You feel you can, you know, when the moon rises above a mountain, one of the mountains look like hills. The Himalayas look like hills in Tibet. You know, that's the way it is. Kailash is 21,000 feet above sea level, but seems so much, you know, as if you can reach out and touch it. And that's why I think, you know, it translates into crystal mountain, really like this, you know, pinnacle, crystal pinnacle, this linga of crystal, which you can't climb, obviously, but which you can access at different points when you do the parikrama. There's a parikrama which takes 3 days around the mountain, and a parikrama of roughly 3 days around Mansarovar. You don't do the whole parikrama of Mansarovar because it's huge, but there's a certain designated route. It was just out of this world. But I also saw how the Chinese communist dominance of China had dealt with religion and culture. You know, the Cultural Revolution had just finished. It was about 11 years after the Cultural Revolution that I went to Tibet. And I saw the ruins of monasteries. I saw statues broken. I saw the kind of destruction. Everything has been rebuilt today, of course. It's a big tourist destination. But I saw all that. So there was a natural beauty that one took inspiration from. But one was also, you know, the sobering sight of all that had happened to this culture, to this people, was also so vividly brought home.
Thank you. I think you perfectly expressed what might move someone, inspire someone to write about it. Okay, let's have a few questions, please. Women as well as men, ideally, and just questions, please.
I have two questions. First, I want to congratulate both of you for the excellent constructive dialogue that you have started. Very good. My question is, we got freedom in 47. They got their liberation in 49. We conveniently forgot Gandhi for the last 70 years. China, we
forgot what?
We conveniently forgot Gandhi in our country. China never forgot Mao, and they will never forget Mao. How do you analyze these things? That is my one question. Second question, you were with Rajiv Gandhi when he went in 1988. Now, I have something to do with that, therefore I must ask this question. 19th January 1988, 6 o'clock, South Block in Delhi. I wrote a letter to Rajiv, I want to meet you alone for half an hour. He gave me time. 6 o'clock, 19th January. You went in September. He asked me a question, why did you want to meet alone? I said, very simple. I want to talk to Rajiv Gandhi, not the Prime Minister of India. He was very happy. I said, next year, 89, is Nehru's 100th anniversary. You must go to China this year and create new friendship. That's the best gift India can give to Nehru's memory. He said, I will do it, and he did it. You were part of it. How are we not able to understand these things? Why are we not being self-critical in our own approach?
Thank you, sir. Why don't you let us know who you are, if you can introduce yourself.
I'll tell
you. Just two questions at a time, I think, please. And yeah.
Let him introduce. Okay. After that, if I understood your question, sir, I don't know your name, but because I can't, I mean, the light is against you. I can't see you at this moment. You say we've forgotten Gandhi in this country. I don't believe so. I just gave a talk on Gandhi in Colombo and Sri Lanka a couple of days ago. And to me, Gandhi is so relevant even today. Although they say that the history of India has not been as non-violent as we make it out to be, I would agree with that. There's been a lot of violence if you look at, you know, us, our, you know, the eras of our history. You said China has not forgotten Mao. I think in both our countries, we sort of enshrine these leaders and it becomes a kind of, you know, self-fulfilling prophecy kind of thing. We enshrine them. Do we really remember them? Do we really revere them? Do we really respect them? That's the question. When you go to the Mao Mausoleum in Tiananmen in Beijing, in central Beijing, there are long crowds lining up to see the embalmed body of Mao. But to what extent, you know, he sort of populates the discourse.
Do they still read the Little Red Book?
No, I didn't see. The Little Red Book is sold on eBay these days. So, and mostly, I think, copies. So to that extent, I think, you know, the jury is out on whether the Chinese remember Mao still. They have a very strong sort of leader now, Xi Jinping, who styles himself in the image of Mao to that extent, I suppose. You have strong leadership coming back in a big way to lead the country. And people in both our countries, I think, like strong leaders. I think they want to be led by the strong and not the weak. So that's another similarity. You spoke about, 1988 and, you know, telling Rajiv Gandhi that he should go to China. And I'm glad he took your advice because, you know, it yielded a lot of benefits for both countries. But, the Hindi-Chini bhai-bhai days, I don't see them coming back at all in this relationship. Hindi Chini Bhai Bhai, for those who are the younger ones among us, really refers to that era when you had Panchsheel, the five principles of peaceful coexistence between India and China, and you had this sort of effulgence, this kind of emotional overdrive when it came to the relationship. And it wasn't designed to last. It really wasn't designed to last because we really hadn't got into serious dialogue about the problems that concerned the relationship, especially the border problem. The issue of Tibet too really didn't go away, because when the troubles began in Tibet and you had the rebellion, the Kampa rebellion in Tibet, and you had the troubles in Lhasa, the Dalai Lama came to India and took refuge here. And I think the world has to recognize the enormous contribution that India has made. You know, we are very, you talk of being self-critical in India. I think we're overly self-critical. We don't appreciate the role that we've played in this country among both the government, the bureaucracy, and the people in keeping alive Tibetan identity and culture. You go to Dharamsala, if you visited Dharamsala, you see the Academy of Tibetan Performing Arts, Tibetan painting, Tibetan literature, Tibetan archives. I mean, we have made an enormous contribution to the global heritage preservation of what Tibet is about.
Thank you, Mrs. Rao. My question is in the context of the maritime strategy in China. Given its increased investments in Africa, and if reports are to be believed today, there are private buying in Australia as well, is it a lost battle for India in terms of maritime strategy? And my second question is about soft power. You spoke there's a lot of possibilities for us within China. I'd like to look at it from outside of China. They've had their Confucius Institutes, language learning thing. India hasn't been able to quite do that. Again, have we lost the plot there, or is it still open? Is it an option that is still open to us?
Well, I don't want this to become a strategic seminar. So if you can take that first question as addressing the geostrategic hard power issues in general.
Yeah, you spoke about the maritime scenario, and I'm basically referring to the Indian Ocean as the arena of competition between India and China. We're seeing it already unfolding in our neighborhood. I think you have to look at it in a 360-degree way. You have to look at what the Chinese are doing in Pakistan, what they're doing in the other South Asian countries. I was just referring to my trip to Sri Lanka, and I saw the sharp sort of increase in Chinese presence there. I think the Chinese have deep pockets today. They have the monetary and financial wherewithal and the power to deploy those resources. They have a speed of implementation, which I think we in India need to our gig as far as implementation is concerned leaves much to be desired. I've worked in government and I can be self-critical about that also. The fault, dear Brutus, lies not in the stars but in ourselves, as they say. So I think we need to do much more about that. Coming to your question about whether the battle has been lost, I wouldn't say the battle has been lost. I think India's strengths come from the fact that we are a democratic, rising power with enormous global potential. We have friends, literally, like Mao said, all over the world. There's enormous goodwill for India, which I don't see for China. Our naval, our blue water capability, the fact that many of our South Asian neighbors, forget Pakistan, look at Sri Lanka. India is Sri Lanka's only neighbor, if you really look. Gandhiji used to say that Sri Lanka is a pearl that is dropped off the nose ring of India. It's really like that. It's so close. It's a heartbeat away from India. So we have the capacity to influence events in our neighborhood in a way that China still has not developed. Never mind the enormous numbers of Chinese workers that come in, or the port that they built in Hambantota, or the development of Chittagong, or Gwadar, or things like that. It's true. physically, their presence is mounted in terms of defense capability, or military, I wouldn't say defense, military capability. You see their presence. You see their infrastructural capabilities, this whole Belt and Road initiative, the One Belt, One Road. All that is coming, you know, to screens near us, literally. So that we have to contend with, and I think every morning, I think we need to do these very hard-nosed assessments of what the Chinese are doing and how we can better counter and strategize. It's not a question of tactical maneuvers about exercises that we may have today or tomorrow or next month. I think we need a long-term strategy about how we're going to counter the Chinese, whether it's in our neighborhood relationships, whether in our capacity to deploy military strength in our region, the military presence we deploy beyond our shores, our capacity to be net security providers. That's a very, you know, stock phrase that we issue. What is it that we need to do to become the leading power that we want to be? Not just, you know, a balancing power or a hedging presence in the region. I think those questions need to be answered more than whether it's, you know, we declare victory or defeat. I think with big countries, I don't think defeat is really an option. I don't think it's an option. The second question that, sorry, I missed that.
I might just have to cut you off there, because if we draw Nirupama out on everything we need to know about China, it will be another era of Indo-Chinese
relations. Soft power. She asked about the Confucius Institutes.
If you'd like to take it quickly.
I mean, I agree with you. I think the Confucius Institutes are, you know, giving everybody a run for their money today. I don't see why we cannot. You see, the power of our soft power, you know, you can multiply it so many times over what the Chinese can do. But it's just that we haven't got our act together on that. I think cultural diplomacy is important as a force multiplier. I think we should understand that. And I don't see why we can't have Tagore Institutes all over the world. You know, every university that has South Asia studies, why don't we start bringing in, you know, the study of Indian language, more than that, the study of Indian culture, art, history, our capacity to manage diversity, all that, I think, is the message we need to send the world.
Thank you so much. So obviously China is going, I really apologize for people holding the mics, but we are out of time. China's going to be a great growing power in the world and an influence on all of our lives. And it's a great privilege to have you here to share some perspectives on it. And we look forward to your book and your writing in the future to help us understand it.
Thank you so much. Thank you.